In mid-September 2013, Tim Holtz and Ranger released 6 additional colors in the Distress paint line. Crushed Olive, Dusty Concord, Gathered Twigs, Pumice Stone, Ripe Persimmon, and Scattered Straw. Today we'll work with these new colors, alone and in combination with existing ones, and explore techniques and ways to use them, taking advantage of those unique Distress paint properties. Let's begin today with something that I think of as finger painting. I am actually going to apply the paint with my fingers, so I think it's fairly aptly named. I'm going to use Crushed Olive, which is one of the new colors, Mowed Lawn, and Broken China. Now, this Crushed Olive color, I really, really like. It's a really acidy yellow-green that I think is really cool. So all I'm going to do, and remember, you have to shake Distress paints all of the time when you use them. It's important to let that mixing ball do its job and get that paint mixed around. So you see that I've put 3 blobs out here on my work table, and I'm just going to kind of randomly blend these colors with my fingers. I'm going to pick them up and smooth them across the tag, and depending on where I put my fingers in the color is obviously going to determine what I get on this tag. So you can kind of gradate the colors a little bit here. You can just sort of let them mix as you work with them, or you can try for a little bit more distinct color. It's really up to you. It's just what you want to do and how you find that you're working on any given day. And so you can either do what I'm doing now, which is to smooth all these colors out. You can come in and you can do this kind of stuff. You can make marks in the paint with an end of a brush if you want. There's lots of different ways to apply these colors. Now, I'm not seeing enough blue on there to satisfy me, so I'm just going to come back and add a little bit in. There. Okay, so Distress paint has a little bit more open time than most paints do. So it's going to sit here on my work table for a period of time, and I could continue to work with it, and in fact I'm going to do that. When I have leftover paint like this, I don't want to throw it away. I'm way too cheap for that, so I want to find a way to utilize this. I'm going to just give it a little bit of a mist with water, and this is kind of a big puddle, and I don't want big puddly looks. So I'm just going to spread this paint out a little bit, and I'm not real worried if I mix it and blend the colors. Mostly I just want to get it spread out across my work surface. Now, depending on how much paint you have left sort of determines what size tag or you're going to use, or you might pick up one of your journal pages and just kind of smush it down. All I'm going to do is pick this paint up, and how cool is that? You get these random patterns and blobs, and it really allows you to do all kinds of fun things. Now, you can go along and just sort of color this tag so that it's only got this color on it, or you can keep a tag or more to the one side while you're working and then just come in and randomly go ahead and add color to them. Now, the cool thing is that once this dries, Distress paint is permanent, which means it will act as a resist. So I could come back with a spray of dilutions or a spray of color wash or something along those lines, and in the areas where the tag doesn't have any paint on it, it will absorb the new color, that spray that I'm putting on there, and the paint where it's thick enough, because if it's really a thin watered down layer, it won't act as a true resist. But in areas like up here where you can see the light reflecting off the paint because there's a fair amount, once this is dry and I spray it, it will absolutely act as a resist. So this is just sort of the barest beginnings. I'm going to show you several other techniques. There's just an awful lot of ways to use this paint. The Distress wrinkle-free technique works super well with the Distress paints, and it produces really nice, really unusual marbled effects. I'm going to work with 3 colors. I have the new Scattered Straw and Ripe Persimmon and Picked Raspberry. And as always, I'm going to shake the paint so that I'm certain that they're well mixed. And then I'm going to put a blob of color of each on my work surface. And I'm going to give it a little bit of a mist with water. When I do this, I like to wiggle the tag because I find it produces really cool zigzaggy kind of marble looks. You'll experiment and figure out sort of how your hands work and what works best for you, and you just keep trying various things. Now I'm going to turn this over in 1 second so you can see it. How cool is that? Look at those colors and the way that they're marbling. Now I'm going to come back in here and pick up some more colors. You know what? I think I'm going to put a little bit more pink out because there's not quite enough in there to suit me. It's one of my favorite colors, so I really do want to get some of that in this tag. Picked up a little bit there, And again, one of the ways that you can produce this really cool striations in this marbling look is how you wiggle the tag in the paint. I'm doing this and see what I get. Isn't that really cool? You can do this with two colors, you can do this with three colors, you can do this with more colors if you want, but one of the things that you need to be aware of is that if you're not careful, and especially if you use colors that are opposite each other on the color wheel, for example, orange and purple, or orange and green, or purple and green, if you mix them too much, you're going to get a really nasty, muddy color. So what you want to do in those cases is perhaps line the colors up in rows, and then drag your tag through it like this, where you wiggle it a little bit so you get the striations, but not so much that you really blend the colors. Now, obviously, I don't want to let this paint go. There's too much of it on here, and the colors are too pretty to lose it. So I'm going to put that tag to one side, and I want to show you a couple of different things. This is a tag that I've been using to collect leftover paint, and this is a tag that I've been using to collect leftover paint. And if I could put my hands on it, I have another one here someplace that I was using to collect leftover paint, but of course I can't find it. So this is the tag that we did earlier where I finger painted the colors of green on, and then while I was playing a few minutes ago working with this was Dusty Concord and Broken China. I had some left on my work surface like this, and I came in and I just went ahead and I dabbed my tag in it. Again, these are kind of colors that have been left over on my table. Now, one thing that I did do was I made another tag with a green background, and I have this one left over finger painted. This, I believe, is Broken China, and again, Dusty Concord, which is a fabulous color, I might add. I'm going to miss these colors a little bit, and again, I'm going to do this because I want to break up these pools. I don't want big puddles of color. I want more dots. Now, if you're looking to get big blobs of color, then you wouldn't do what I'm doing. It's really a matter of what it is that you're trying to achieve. So now I've got this nice puddly kind of thing going on. Excuse me, these little dot kind of things going on. I'm just going to press and lift. And how cool is that? Now, obviously, some of these colors are opposite each other on the color wheel. They're complementary colors. So they really jump off the tag at you because orange and green are complementary colors. So I'm just going to come in and scooch that down up there. Now, these were bigger blobs, so I got kind of bigger smears. Let's just grab this other tag here. Again, this one is Broken China. And it's Dusty Concord, and I'm going to be careful this time because this is a smaller tag. I don't want to overwhelm this with bigger puddles. Again, really, really cool effects. Now, you can do this on a journal page if you want, and I'll show you that in 1 second. But always, always, always keep some tags to one side that you keep doing this stuff to, and you get these really cool effects. This tag was just leftovers on my table, always leftovers. And let's just drop a little bit of this in here. Again, you get this really cool look. You don't have to use it all up on one tag. Now, let me bring in my Small Dilutions journal. And this is a page that I did earlier. Let me turn it this way. This is the finger painting technique. All I did was smear the colors on here, but I worked in more of a gradient. So what I'm going to do now is lay the journal page in there and use it. How cool is that? Use it to pick up this leftover paint. Again, lots of fun things going on here, and now I can take this page that has nothing on it and do the same thing. And I get the beginnings of, you know, this just layered background. And this is all I'm trying to achieve, is to make an interesting background so that when I get through and I want to collage something on here, or I want to stamp and cut it out and apply it to the page, I have a really interesting background underneath my image. As we've discussed, the open time on distress paints is longer than on a typical acrylic paint. This is the tag that I made a few moments ago using scattered straw, picked raspberry, and ripe persimmon when I showed you the distress wrinkle-free technique. It's probably been sitting for close to 10 minutes now. This is one I did just a moment ago, and I used picked raspberry, broken china, and that lovely new Dusty Concord. Both of these have areas of paint on them that are still wet. You can see that the tags are curled. Now, something interesting that you can do is you can put some inclusions on the paint. Now, I'm not saying in the paint because I'm not mixing this stuff into the paint as I'm using it. I'm applying it to the top of the paint once I've got the paint on the surface, whatever that is. So I'm going to start with some Perfect Pearls. This is Perfect Copper, which is a nice complement to these warm colors on this tag. All I'm going to do is pick up my brush and apply some of the Perfect Pearls to the ends, And then I'm just going to tap it on like this. It's pretty darn easy to do. And any place where the paint is wet, the Perfect Pearls will adhere. Now, with Perfect Pearls, because the binder is built in to the powder, anything that's not wet where the Perfect Pearls are, it's not going to cling automatically because the paint is dry. But you can, once this tag is dry, you can mist it with water, and that will ensure that any of the Perfect Pearls that are sitting on areas of paint that are not wet will go ahead and will adhere. Let me just get the Perfect Pearls off my work table. And now what I have left is this other tag with these colors, the Picked Raspberry, the Dusty Concord, and the Broken China. This is Distress Glitter. And what I'm going to do is just sprinkle some in various areas on here. Now you could use regular glitter like our Joggles glitter if you want, but I thought it would be fun, because this glitter is opaque, I thought it would be fun to come on here and just go ahead and apply some glitter. Now, there is no binder in glitter, so you have to be aware of that. You've got to make certain that you're putting the glitter in an area of wet paint. I just used Picked Raspberry. This is now the Clear Rock Candy, which provides some glimmer without any real color. And again, you can apply this as heavily as you want or as light as you want. It's really up to you. And this is, I believe this is Tumbled Glass. So let me just turn this way so you can see the area. Because the tag is curling, it's a little harder for you to see the area on the back here. But again, all I've done is I've applied color on here. And somewhere here I have a couple that are already done. I had these put to one side and now I have no idea what I did with them. All right, this is Perfect Pearls. And these two have some glitter. Let me move these to one side. Get all of this out of the way and clear this up. Again, just some tags that I've put various inclusions on top of. Let me get this out of the way. This has some I think it's Forever Violet Perfect Pearls on it. And both of these tags just have, you know what, this one doesn't have the Rock Candy on it. There's another one here someplace that does. But this just has Clear Rock Candy. And when the light hits this, you can see the reflection on, and again, this is just the Clear Rock Candy, so the color of the paint is going to show through, unlike here, where you're going to see the color of the glitter as well as the color of the paint. So you can sort of gussy up your paints in various ways by using glitter and Perfect Pearls. At first blush, you might not think of some of these new distress colors as being suitable for flowers, but when you go ahead and you make what I call my scribble flowers, they work perfectly well. I have each of the six new colors already arranged with some circles started here, and this is dry. For this technique to be effective, you have to either use a heat gun to dry the paint or just sit it and let it allow to dry on its own. But the color has to be dry before you go ahead and add the next one. So again, six new colors. Who thinks brown and gray work for flowers? I'm going to show you that they will. We're just going to layer some other colors on here, and this is Picked Raspberry, and all I'm going to very lightly do is just go ahead and make another circle over the top. Again, it works wonderfully with this acid green, which is crushed olive. Of course, it's going to work really well with the purple and the scattered straw. The key, again, is making certain that you allow that first layer of paint to dry, because if you don't, you're going to mix mud in some cases rather than having two distinct colors. Now, when I do this, I kind of play and play and play until I'm satisfied with the way that these look. Again, ordinarily with purple and yellow, you'd get some awful brown color, nasty, muddy stuff. Not this way, you won't. Again, you're just going to come in and layer all these colors. Now, you're not seeing me shake the paint very often because I've been working with them in between. They're pretty well shook up, so I don't have to spend a lot of time doing that now, but you should remember to go ahead and shake your paints if you've put them down and haven't used them for a little while. And a little while might mean 10 minutes. I mean, they do need to be shaken to keep them well mixed inside. I'm going to come back with some more of the Dusty Concord. I think this is probably my favorite color in the entire set, followed closely by Picked Raspberry. I'm very fond of Picked Raspberry too. And you can see that you just layer these colors on. Now, I can only do two layers here because obviously I need for this to dry, and there's nothing less fun than watching paint dry, which I'm not going to ask you to do. So I'm going to put this to one side, get these bottles of paint out of the way, and I'm going to bring in a sheet that I've already gone ahead and put lots of layers of color on, and you can see I've begun to do some of my scribble flowers. Once your paint is dry, I like to use a Pitt F fine tip pen. I like the way that this works. I think it's the one that I enjoy most for this kind of technique. And when I do this, I'm most definitely not looking for perfection. All I want to do is just get some flowers on here. And then the magical part begins when you start to put this white on here, because it really highlights the flowers and makes them look quite interesting. Now this one is a little bit close to this previous one, but that's okay, I can make that work. Doesn't matter if the petals are all the same length, if they're all perfectly aligned, it just doesn't matter. For this kind of a flower, when I do these, the differences among them are, I think, what really makes them interesting. If they were perfect, they look like they came from my garden or from, you know, something that somebody drew with perfection in mind. So once I get my flower drawn, all I'm going to do, this is the Unisigno Broadpoint White Pen, and it's the one that I like best, again, for doing this technique. I've tried it with a white jelly roll pen. I prefer this. So all I'm going to do is I'm going to lightly, well, first I need to get my pen started. I'm going to just lightly come over here and go around these areas. I don't want solid coverage on the white, so I'm just going to lightly draw over these petals so I'm getting some highlighting on them. Again, I'm not trying to obscure the black. I just want to add a little bit of a highlight there. Once I have all my petals outlined and my center outlined, I'm going to come in and I'm going to tap this pen just like this, and you can't see it here because I'm doing white on white, but this is going to get the ink flowing out of the tip of the pen and it's going to leave a nice little rounded puddle, and that's what I do in my centers. Now, more often than not, I stick to black and white when I do these, but there is a certain charm that comes along with bringing in some other colors. For example, if I took this flower, and let's just say that I drew a circle at the end of each of the petals, and these are so much fun to doodle. I mean, you can sit in front of the TV and just, once you have your colors all dry, you can just doodle at will and bring in all kinds of fun things. So, jelly roll pens. I like the metallic colors probably the best, so I'm going to use metallic purple. Again, I'm going to do the same thing on a scratch section. I just want to get that color flowing, and then I'm just going to dab it in that circle that I drew. And so, when you do these, I mean, obviously, I've done a video just about doing these flowers, which I'll give you a link to. It will be where this is posted on the website. But you can do these, and then you can cut them out and make all kinds of wonderful embellishments. You can collage them on your pages. You cut the flower out, you draw a stem and some leaves, again, with this fine pit pen, and you make some really wonderful things with them. So all these colors, and who would have thought that brown and gray, when you add some other colors to them, would make such interesting flowers, but they really do. One of the nicest things about distress paint, in addition to all of these wonderful colors, especially the six new ones, is its versatility. It can be used on many different surfaces. And in addition to that, you can stamp with it. So this is a Hero Art stamp, and you can see that I've already done it once here. I'm going to give my paint a little bit of a shake, and I'm just going to go ahead and ink up this stamp. Now, because distress paints are suitable for use on many surfaces, if you are not careful and you let this paint dry on this rubber stamp, you will ruin it. So you have to be careful that you go ahead and wet this and rinse that paint off as soon as you're done with it. Now you can see that I've got some contamination on the top of that dabber. All I need to do is scooch this around while squeezing the bottle to force some paint through, and it will go away. I can wipe it on a paper towel. Now, in order to get this inked up, I probably have far more paint on here than what I need, so I'm going to grab just a trashy tag that I'm not going to do anything with, and I'm going to stamp off the heaviest of the paint. And you can see that the elements that make up this flower are all filled in here because there was so much paint on there. So the second iteration of the stamp typically is better than the first. So I'm just going to lightly press this on there, and I'm going to lift straight up. And you can see now that I've got that definition on there, and I can actually see the lines in the stamp. So it's not just a blob like this one was. And I bet I can get a third generation stamp out of here too. Just go ahead and lightly press that down. Now obviously there's a little less paint on there, so you're going to get a little less definition, but this great backgrounds. You can do all kinds of fun things to add layer and texture to the backgrounds of your journal pages and obviously your tags. I'm going to spray this with water and I'm just going to put it to one side and let it sit like that. You don't need to see me clean a stamp. You know how to do that. I'm just going to get this out of the way, and I know that that will remain wet so that I can go ahead and clean it up when I'm through. Now, I talked about the fact that distress works really well on many surfaces, and someplace here is my small dilutions journal, and let me turn this around. This background was done with distress paint. This is the one that you saw earlier where I had one half of the page done and I kind of smushed the journal around in the leftover paint, and then I came back and I spritzed some After Midnight dilutions on there, dilutions ink sprays, and I spritzed some other things on there. I stamped with a different stamp and kind of got some blotchy background things going on. I used a lid to, actually it's a lid to one of these spray bottles, and of course I can't put my hands on one at the moment, just to get these circles. So my background is basically ready and I want to get started on this. I want to get on this a little bit further. And what I'm basically going to do is imitate what I've done here. So these webs along the side come from the Dilutions Day of the Heads set, and this house and this broken plaster kind of thing that's going on here are from the This Old House set. Now I'm not going to finish this, you don't need to see me do that, but what I want to show you is that you can use the distress paint. Again, it's multi-surface, so you can use it on lots of different things. These are some of the Ideology Alpha parts, and I have some big letters, some big numbers here, and then a smaller set that includes both letters and numbers. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to pop out a 3 and a 1, because obviously Halloween is the 31st of October. And I'm going to actually be able to color these using my distress paint. Let me just put that there. Now, the reason I brought these larger ones in here was because initially I wanted to use these on this tag, and I realized that, you know, proportionally they're way too big, it won't work. But they will work on this page. So I'm going to get this number 3 out of here. You know what? I need to grab these are Tim's tonic scissors, and these cut this plastic really, really well. I like these scissors for this kind of stuff. Makes short work of getting these number parts out of this plastic that, you know, when they're injection molded, they're molded with these little pieces that hold it into one large unit. So I'm not going to show you everything. I just want to show you that you can use the distress paint to color this plastic. So I'm just going to, again, use my tonic scissors to nip off the excess plastic that's on there, and let me get this journal out of the way. So I have my number, and I think, well, you know what, I need to trim this. And I think what I'm probably going to do is paint these a combination of orange and purple. I really like that. I think it's fun. First of all, they're complementary colors, so they sit opposite of each other on the color wheel, and though they make mud when you mix them, they actually make really cool combinations when you use them together. So this is the new Ripe Persimmon and Dusty Concord. All I'm going to do, again, I'm going to give this a shake, is I'm going to tap, tap, tap my color on here. Come in with the Dusty Concord. And I'm going to do the same thing. Now, I can leave some of this black showing through. I don't have to solidly cover these elements if I don't want to, and I think that looks kind of fun, so I'm going to leave that way. Again, it's very simple to clean this off. It's just squishing it out a little bit onto your surface and then just cleaning it off with a paper towel. We've looked at lots of different ways today that you can use distress paint. And with the addition of these 6 new colors into the line, we've got Dusty Concord, Ripe Persimmon, Pumice Stone, Scattered Straw, Gathered Twigs, and Crushed Olive. With the addition of these 6 colors into the line, it just expands it a little bit further, and I'm sure Ranger at some point will give us all of the colors in the distress line in the paint, but in the meantime, I'm certainly going to make do with these colors.